Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Earls Hall Baptist Church. Welcome to our Sunday morning service on today, Sunday the 8th of November. It's wonderful to have you join with us, and I trust that today this service will be a real blessing and an encouragement to you. Today is the 8th of November, which is today Remembrance Sunday. So at just around 11 o'clock, we're going to share a time of remembering, thinking of those who have fought and died in our nation and for our country. And we're going to think and spend time in remembering and standing together at that time. But as we gather, as we seek to come together before God just now, shall we just pray? Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are an awesome God, and that over all the world just now, you hold us in your loving arms. We thank you that you are God and that there is no other Savior. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that we know of you, that we can live for you, and that you give us hope today in the world in which we live. Help us to keep our eyes on you and bless us as we spend time together in this service. Amen. Let me read a few verses from Isaiah, and then we're going to sing a song of praise. These are words from Isaiah 43, when Isaiah is speaking God's word to God's people. I, yes, I am the Lord. There is no other Savior. First I predicted your rescue, then I saved you and proclaimed it to all the world. No foreign God has ever done this. You are witnesses that I am the only God, says the Lord. From eternity to eternity, I am God. No one can snatch anyone out of my hand. No one can undo what I have done. These are great words of praise joining us together. If you're on Facebook this morning and you're joined in live with us, please do say hi in the comments. Good morning to Tim, to Dennis, to Kim, to Sue, Alan, Hannah, Christine, and John. Please do say hi in the chat. It's good to know that you're joining with us this morning. As we think of those words from Isaiah, from eternity to eternity, I am God. Let's worship God who stood before creation. It's good to worship God. I wonder if you did stand as you sang that worship song to God. It's good to be able to worship God in this way, isn't it? To sing songs of praise. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. I've got a few notices this morning. We've got an autumn trail coming up. This is to get out in the fresh air, follow the route, spotting autumn pictures along the way. The trail's going to start and end in the church car park. And there's going to be prizes, but the prizes won't be able to be picked up. Because of the changes to the lockdown restrictions, we're not actually allowed to give away the prizes in the middle of the lockdown. However, any prizes that we're able to give out, we will give out once the lockdown has ended. But you are able to enter into this trail, and it's a good opportunity to get out, to walk out with your family, to walk out and to just spend some time together in the fresh air. It'll obviously be sunny on Saturday the 14th of November. It might be a bit chilly, but it will be dry for sure, right? But between 10 and 1 on Saturday the 14th of November, please do come along to the church car park to begin and end that autumn trail. We really look forward to you joining with us in that. There's a couple of other things. We've got Alpha starting on Wednesday. Andy's going to be leading that through at 8 o'clock. If you've never done the Alpha course, please do consider signing up for it. You can get in touch with me at my email address, minister@earlshall.com, and I can put you in touch with Andy and get you signed up for that. Alpha allows you to explore the meaning of life and ask the big questions of life. And it's a great way to ask different questions that are maybe on your heart. And over this time of lockdown, I know that there have been people who have had a lot of questions on their mind and heart. So if you want to know more, please do email me and I can put you in touch with Andy. But it starts this Wednesday at 8 o'clock online via Zoom. And all the details can be sent to you if you'd like to be part of that. Can I also remind you that Anna has set up the Jigsaw Lending Library. So if you have Jigsaw puzzles that you would like to donate, please do get in touch with her through me, again, through emailing me. If you would like to receive a puzzle during the next month or so, or even going on beyond that, please, again, do get in touch with me. And if you would like to be a courier safely transporting puzzles from house to house, again, please do get in touch with me and I will put you in touch with Anna. And those of you who enjoy doing jigsaws can enjoy sharing in that way. Every year we seek to support our community in different ways. And we've been supporting Off the Streets for a number of years now. And for Christmas, we are going to be bringing in different things for Off the Streets. And I'm going to let Liz explain this just now.
Good morning, everyone. We've decided this year to support Off the Streets with Christmas gifts for their clients. We've often made up shoeboxes, but this year we thought it would be good to support the work of Off the Streets. At the moment, they're not able to open the shelter, but they are still really busy visiting people who are living on the streets and those who have been moved into bed and breakfast accommodation. They would really like toiletries, biscuits, chocolates and selection packs to give to the people that they're meeting. We'd like to make a collection at church by the 12th of December to give us time to get the gifts over to Off the Streets so that they can give them out before Christmas. If this is something you'd like to be involved in, please can you arrange to drop off any of the gifts to the church before the 12th of December, and then we'll put them together in packages for Off the Streets to give out. Be a really nice way of supporting the work that they're doing in our area. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz. So we're going to be able to support Off the Streets. We would usually, as you know, make up shoeboxes for the shoebox appeal. But this year, because we know that we're going to be able to definitely get these things to Off the Streets in the centre of Southend, this is what we've decided to do. So toiletries, biscuits, chocolates, selection boxes, all of these things. Now, we realise that through the lockdown, getting out is not going to be easy to do, and bringing things to the church building again may not be easy to do, though we are going to be open on Sunday afternoons at 4 o'clock for prayer. But after the lockdown, we have a period of time before the 12th of December where things can easily be brought to the church building. So if you want to start getting things when you're at the shops, toiletries, biscuits, chocolates, or selection boxes for that donation, please do, start to do that just now. And then when we get past the immediate lockdown that we're in, we will be able to bring those things to the church building, and we'll be able to take them down to off the streets where they can be distributed and where there'll be a real blessing. Thank you to Liz for coordinating that. Can you put a date in your diary for the last Sunday in November, Sunday the 29th at 6 p.m. We're going to have a quiz. We're going to raise funds for the Indian Orphanage, and we would love you to be part of that. So please do put that date and time in the diary. It's going to be a Zoom quiz, hopefully between ourselves, Hadley Baptist and West Lee Baptist, or including teams from all these different churches. We can have quite a lot of different teams involved. And then we can raise funds for the orphanage and also have fun together. Well, it's fun for the winning team anyway, and perhaps for everyone involved in the quiz. So please do put that date in the diary. Last Sunday in November, 6 p.m. This is going to be our church anniversary quiz as well as a fundraiser for the Indian Orphanage. Lots that's going on. Lots that we can be getting involved with. Let's hear now from Katie. Good morning, Katie.
Good morning. Are you any good at remembering things? Most people have different ways to help them remember things, don't they? Because it's really hard just to try and keep everything up in your head all the time. Perhaps you're the kind of person who writes little sticky notes and leaves them everywhere. Maybe you like to have a little notebook on the side with lists of things to tick off as you do them. Or perhaps you write everything in a diary. Some of you might have a homework diary for school. You might set an alarm on your phone to help you to remember to do something really, really important. I have a bad habit of writing on my hand because it's always there in front of me. Until I wash my hands, and then it all goes blurry and I have no idea what it says and what I was supposed to do. Today is Remembrance Sunday. Lots of people choose to wear a poppy around this time to remember everyone who lost their lives and their families as a result of wars and conflicts over many years. Soon we will have a time of silence as we take that time to remember them together. It might surprise you to hear that in the Bible it says that God remembers us. That might sound a bit strange at first. I mean, is that saying that God can forget us then? Maybe he needs to write a sticky note down somewhere to help him remember us, or maybe he needs to set an alarm on his phone. That doesn't sound right, does it? Of course it's not right. He is the Almighty God. It means the opposite, really, that he never forgets us in the first place and never will. God knows us and loves us, and even when things feel difficult and when things feel very dark, he doesn't forget us. So if you're wearing your poppy today, remember those who gave their lives in war. Also, be aware that our Almighty God remembers you. Whatever you're doing and however you are feeling today.
Thank you, Katie. Those are really helpful words for us today on our Remembrance Sunday service. We're going to hear now and share in our prayers of intercession. Andy's going to lead these. Remember that as Andy speaks and then prays, we join with him as we worship God in this way. Andy, would you lead us in prayer?
Good morning, Tom, and good morning to all of you. Well, this is the first weekend of the stay-at-home lockdown, And as we entered this new period, the government's decision to extend the furlough scheme until next March came as welcome news. But these are challenging times for everyone, and at different times and for different reasons, we may all experience tough going. Please don't allow yourselves to be overwhelmed before reaching out, and please don't wait to act if you become aware of a person in need. At the church meeting a couple of weeks ago, Tom invited church members to use the church directory as a prompt for prayer and for keeping in touch with one another. Please do use it to keep different people in your thoughts and prayers and to give someone a call. And if you're wondering where God is in all of this, or wanting to remind yourselves of what it is about the Christian faith that gives us hope, you are most welcome to join the Alpha course that is starting at 8 o'clock this Wednesday evening. There's a link on our website, or you can contact Tom or me to find out more. My email address is andy.smith@earlshall.com. We shall also pray for the American presidential election, which at the time I'm recording these prayers has yet to reach a definitive conclusion. Passion and belief are running high in America at this moment, with a force that is driving people apart. We will remember them and uphold the nation in our prayers. Today is also Remembrance Sunday, and we may find ourselves feeling a little awkward, possibly even uncomfortable about today, because of our sense of unease towards conflict and war. For most of us, such things happen out there, far removed from our experience. At the same time, we want to know that we are protected, and that if and when anything should happen that threatens us or our way of life, the country has the capability to respond swiftly and effectively. When we see on our television screens the impact and consequences on people of the action of repressive regimes, we might find ourselves enraged by a sense of injustice and cry out for someone to do something. And the Apostle Paul spoke about Christians being engaged in a spiritual battle. So how should we respond? I suggest we let God know if we find this a difficult, even a challenging issue, and to pause for a moment to remind ourselves that even if it is something far removed from our experience, there are wars and conflicts taking place in many parts of the world at the moment. To take stock that there is something about the human condition that can compel us towards conflict, and that our creative abilities have the potential to cause great harm as well as achieve great good. That humankind can display acts of ghastly brutality as well as breathtaking kindness towards one another. To reflect on the damage to and the loss of life, and also of the impact this has on the lives of others, most especially the lives of families and loved ones. To consider that living in peace is something that needs to be worked at and encouraged. And as we prepare to join in the 2 minute silence, we remember with gratitude all those in our armed forces who have fought, been wounded, or died protecting us and others around the world, and at a cost that many of them and their families continue to pay. And also to remember those who continue to work to maintain our peace and security in these uncertain and volatile times. Let us pray. Lord, we pray for our nation during this second phase of lockdown. We may find ourselves in different places to the ones we once knew. For some of us, these are unwelcome and frightening places and not where we want to be. Remind us that however far we may have moved, you have no problem in finding us, and that there is no place we can be that you cannot enter. May we know your presence and your peace. Be with our government and their advisers. Give them clarity of thinking and understanding at this difficult time. Enable them to make wise decisions and to communicate these clearly and that make for easy understanding. Lord, we also pray for your peace to fall onto the heady mix of emotions in America. When they run so high, attitudes and opinions can quickly become polarized and fixed. Prevent them from igniting into flashpoints of anger and retaliation. Encourage those in positions of leadership to dial down the rhetoric and for decisions on next steps to be made through sober judgment and with the well-being of the whole nation in mind. May the things that need to be done to achieve this be done, and those actions that are self-seeking or self-serving to be tempered and stopped. On this Remembrance Sunday, we ask you to help us to reflect on the priorities of life and the cost of war and conflict. To pause and consider the way that freedom and peace often come with a price, and to remember those, their families and loved ones who have paid that price. May we not forget as the generations pass. May we value peace and work towards achieving and sustaining it. Help us in these efforts, Lord. Our prayer is that you would bring peace to the war-torn places of the world, a peace that is sustainable and just, that is dignified and honourable, a peace on which your spirit can fall and achieve the healing of the nations. Lord, we continue to pray for people in our fellowship who are struggling with ill health at this time, for Pam Meekins, who is very worried that the wound on her leg is not healing and is severely restricting her ability to move around her house. For Alan Maynard, for Michael Everett, who are suffering with bad backs. For Betsy Raitsu, recovering from a severe chest infection. And for Linda Milner. Lord, be close to all these people. They are precious to you and their families and friends. Support them and encourage them and bring them healing. Be with their families and loved ones. Refresh their spirits and give them renewed strength. And Lord, in a moment of quiet, we bring before you others we know in need of help from you. Lord, our desire is for others to come to know and to follow you. We pray for the Alpha Course starting this week. The invitation is open. May it be seen and taken up by those who are searching for answers. And as they listen to the Alpha presentations and ask their questions, may they discover the answer is found in you. Lord, we ask all these prayers in and through the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Andy, for leading us in prayer, especially at this time. We're getting very close to spending a few minutes in our act of remembrance. As we share together in this, we're going to watch a video that leads us through 11 o'clock and the 2 minutes of silence. We're going to hear the bugle at the start and at the end of this 2 minute period. And if you are able to, and would like to, you are also invited to stand for this period of time. As we remember, we may be remembering those in our own families. We may be thinking of what we have seen in the news of wars around the world. But as we think, as we remember those who have given their lives for others, that we may know peace. So would you stand with me as we share in an act of remembrance together? Please stand. Friends, let us remember in silence before God all those who have died in war. Thank you. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. Well, thank you for joining with us in that act of remembrance. Shall we pray together? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your presence with us just now. Lord, for those whose memories are full of those whom they have loved and lost, we pray for your comfort just now. We pray for your peace to be upon us. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love for us. And we pray that in all our remembering, we would also remember who we are in you. Help us to live for you, Lord Jesus, today. Amen. We're going to sing a worship song. Everlasting God, the years go by, but you're unchanging. Well, it's good to be able to worship God in song, isn't it? Yesterday, today and forever, you are the same. You never change. Great words for us to hold on to at this present moment in time. Our reading this morning is taken from Titus. As we continue our study in Titus, thinking about being disciples, today we're thinking about being disciples in this world. The passage is short, so just a couple of verses, so I'm going to read them this morning. Titus 3, 1 to 2. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and always to be gentle toward everyone. As we come before this passage, let's just pray. Lord God, we thank you for your word which lives and breathes and speaks to us. We trust that this morning, as we hear these words that Paul wrote to Titus, for Titus to share with the church in Crete, that you, Lord, would let us hear your voice. We ask this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. On this Remembrance Sunday, we find ourselves at a passage of scripture that invites the church to remember. Paul wants Titus to get the church in Crete to remember, and to remember how they should behave for the sake of everyone. This is a passage about the church's witness, and it calls to mind other teachings that Paul has said about being a witness in the world. But here there's this focus on being a witness and how behavior and attitude affect others. Now, Titus has already said a lot to Paul, and has already heard a lot from Paul, hasn't he? He has been asked to speak into people's lives. He has been asked to correct, to build up, to challenge. He's been told that he is to personally encourage and rebuke. He is to speak to the congregation and teach them to be self-controlled. And now Paul says to him that he is to remind the people of what he himself, that's Paul, had already told them when he was with them briefly in Crete. And he is saying to the church in Crete, you must live out your faith well. You got to practice your faith well. You got to live it out. You got to be who you say you are. If you're living for Jesus, live that out where you are. Paul is really telling the church through Titus that their effective witness to the world about who Jesus Christ is one that is to be inoffensive. It's to be an inoffensive witness. And to us today, it sounds as though Paul is saying that living for Jesus should be inconspicuous. And that's maybe not quite how we would think we should be today as we think about our witness to the world. But for the church in Crete, Paul said that this was the appropriate witness for the church. Be subject to rulers and authority. Be obedient. Be ready to do whatever is good. Slander no one. Be peaceable. Be considerate. Always be gentle toward everyone. Is that normal? What was going on in Crete to make this way of living for the church the best way of living? What was going on to make this way of living the best way of living? Well, as we heard a few weeks ago, there were some issues in Crete. They didn't have a high reputation, did they? They were liars, we heard. They weren't of high repute. 2,000 years ago, the people on Crete were regarded as proud of themselves, and they even took pride in the elderly who would go out and get drunk. In a culture where that was where high praise sat, there were clearly issues. This culture in Crete had a blind spot for those who lied. They were happy with those who were violent. And in light of this, Paul tells Titus that the church is to be different to the culture in which they are set. There was a Greek historian called Polybius, forgive my pronunciation if I've not got that right, but Polybius wrote about 150 years before the birth of Jesus. And he's probably most famous for writing about the rise of the Roman Republic. In his The Histories of Polybius, he says this. He says that it's almost impossible to find personal conduct more treacherous or public policy more unjust than in Crete. Cretan society was not a healthy society. It was a mess of vanity, of lying, and of slander. A culture of deceit. The church, now emerging in Crete, was in a setting that we can perhaps hardly imagine today. Can you think of a society where there is praise for liars? Well, if you can, hold that one in mind. But to this list that we have in these two verses, Paul is saying to the church that you are to counteract the culture and attitude, the general way of life in Crete. You, church, are to behave obediently and peaceably so that the life of the church will stand out, will be seen as different, and will grow. Paul's direction to Titus is very specific to the culture in Crete. This sounds like a way of being that is very much about being a doormat in society, though, doesn't it? It doesn't sound great. Remind the people to be subject. We don't like that word. To be obedient. Do we need to be obedient? To do what's good? Well, okay, I can live with doing whatever's good. Slandering no one, yeah, I can see the benefit of that. To be peaceable and considerate, yes, again, appropriate. But to be gentle towards everyone? I'm not sure I like that. We may think today. But you know, this isn't about being a doormat in society. Paul ends here saying that the church has to be gentle. Yes, gentle. And Jesus teaches something similar in Matthew 5, 38 to 42 as part of his Sermon on the Mount. In that passage, Jesus, teaching to the crowds, says this: "You have heard the law that says the punishment must match the injury, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, offer the other cheek also. If you are sued in court and your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. If a soldier demands that you carry his gear for a mile, carry it 2 miles. Give to those who ask, and don't turn away from those who want to borrow." Now, we've looked at this passage in the past as a church, and what we saw when we did that was that what Jesus says to the culture that he is writing into, which is a different culture to that on Crete, he is challenging things that were normal in society. It was permissible to slap someone on one cheek if they had offended you. But if you offered them the other cheek, then that was something that was offensive back. It invited someone to do something worse that they weren't allowed to do. A soldier, a Roman soldier, could ask a Jew to carry his backpack and his pack for 1 mile, but he wasn't allowed to take it for a further mile. So to offer to take it for a further mile would embarrass the Roman soldier. This teaching of Jesus actually taught an undermining of the normal way of thinking. It ran countercultural. And Paul does the same here for Titus in Crete in these few verses. What he teaches is basically an instruction to act honourably, to act humbly in society, but to act differently in the good ways that you can. The church stood out in Crete because It was a society in fragmentation, but it was a part of the society that pulled together. In a society where there is gossip, we wouldn't slander each other. In a country where pride comes first, we will always seek to put others ahead of ourselves. That is the life of the church, but it is not therefore to be a doormat, but it is to stand apart from the culture of the day in a healthy and good way. Paul's teaching to Titus is like Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount. It is culturally undermining, but points always to God. It honours God, and it is an active witness to Jesus who is at work in our lives. For the church to stand out, they need to stand out with their love for each other and their love for God, and this will affect everyone around them. Do you see that? They are to be gentle toward everyone. What they do is seen by the world around them. In Crete, this is true, and today, this is true. How we behave is seen by others. So what does this list mean for us today? Well, a church that is full of those who are obedient, who are ready to do good, and who will slander no one, and who will be peaceable and considerate and gentle, will certainly affect a chaotic, loud, and violent culture. A culture where there is not really any great confidence in public policy, and where there is treachery in personal conduct, which is what Polybius said. Living for Jesus today is still putting Jesus first, which is what Paul has been getting Titus to teach the church in Crete. Living for Jesus is more than just knowing we are saved then, because it reveals that there's a way to live. And that is what Paul is teaching Titus. And that is what we need to hear today. Living for Jesus is more than just knowing that we are saved. Yes, we absolutely need to know we are saved. Don't mishear me. That is really, really, really important to know that we're saved. But there's more. It's more than a decision that we make once and then maybe think about occasionally. If we say we live for Jesus, then we need to be reminded that living for Jesus impacts our lives, impacts our behaviour, and our decisions. More than that, in fact, as we think about being Jesus' disciples today, to be his close followers, disciples in this world today, now, we see that the behaviour of individual believers affects the whole witness of the church. That was true in Crete, and it's true today. Our individual expression of faith now in our day-to-day life affects how the church is viewed by those around us. Our individual journey of faith has an impact on how the whole church is seen and understood. Think about that. If you've got one friend and you're the only person who they know who is part of a church, then they will understand church by looking at you. Your behaviour, your actions and your attitudes. And yes, we are allowed to make mistakes, but we are to seek to be gracious and kind. The passage invites the witness to be obedient, to do what is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate and gentle and loving. This is how we are to live. This is how we are seen. So those things that Paul teaches to Titus don't teach a doormat mentality, but reveal a personal witness statement, how we are to live, how we will be seen by our friends, our neighbours, our colleagues, our co-workers. Our faith is personal, absolutely. But as Paul said right at the start of this letter to Titus, our faith is a common faith. It is a shared faith. We are disciples together. We live for Jesus together. And that is a beautiful and a wonderful thing, because that makes us part of the church. But do you see that Paul is showing Titus once more that living for Jesus is not just about individual faith, but is about the whole community of faith? And it's not even just the church community that's impacted, it's the whole wider community that's impacted by the church. The witness of the church to our Saviour and Lord Jesus Christ is most powerfully seen when we act with humility, but also with confidence in who we are in Christ. It is by grace we have been saved. It is in God's grace and forgiveness that we go on in our journey of faith. So our challenge today is to hear Paul's words to Titus and to hold on to them, not just for our sakes, but for the sake of each other and for the wider community around us, that we may be a positive influence, living for Jesus, not being a doormat, not being trod down for the sake of it, but living for Jesus in a way that glorifies God and reveals the wonder of who he is to the world around us. Oh, what grace we know that we may live in this way. We're going to sing a song of praise as we close our service this morning. The song is Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. And as you think about who you are and the things in your life that have been dealt with by the Holy Spirit working in your life, think too about how you are living for him today, how I am living for him today. And ask, Lord, help me live in a way that honours you and reveals you to the world around. Let's sing our song of praise. We've been thinking about how we live our lives. Now, if you're unsure even how to pray about how to live your life, let me encourage you to pray through the words of the Lord's Prayer on the screen. We're going to say these words together, but let these words be our response this morning to how we are to live as people who forgive, to live as people who seek to put God's kingdom first, for people who do not desire to be drawn into temptation. This is our prayer, that we may be who we are meant to be as we seek to live for Jesus, our Saviour and Lord, who has drawn us from darkness to live for the light of life. So let's pray together and say these words together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I trust you know God's grace and peace to you this week, and I will see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock. If you're able to come along for our time of private prayer in the church building, and if not, then I hope to see you on Wednesday evening for our devotion. God bless.